I'm Jim Collison, and live from the Gallup campus here in Omaha, Nebraska, this is Gallup's Called the Coach for October 2nd, 2015. Called the Coach is a resource for those who want to help others discover and use their strengths. We have Gallup experts and independent strengths coaches share tactics, insights, and strategies to help coaches maximize the talent of individuals, teams, and organizations around the world. If you have questions during the live webcast, we do have a live chat room that's available for you. It's right below the main video window, so if you're watching live, just go down there. There's a chat room. You can log in, use the guest account. That's the easiest way. Put your name in there so I know who you are. We will allow you to ask live questions and answer those during the program. That's the best way to do it. So get that done. If you're listening live, love to have you log in as well. If you're listening to the recorded version, or have questions about custom strengths coaching solutions for small, medium, or large organizations, you can contact us easy. Just send us an email, coaching@gallup.com. And there's also a custom contact form right there on the page. If you're there live, you can fill that out as well, and that will come directly to us. Don't forget to visit the Gallup Strength Center. That's just gallupstrengthcenter.com for all your coaching resources and Strengths Finder training needs. You can also catch the video in both streaming and downloadable audio for offline listening. We've been trying to getting a lot of you to subscribe to this through RSS feeds. That's basically, there's an iTunes app on the iPhone, and on Android there are a couple different podcatchers that will allow you to stream these or download them to your phone. And you can listen to them in the car, on a train, or in a plane, and recoup that time that you'd be traveling to listen to these webcasts, podcasts. We'd love to have you do that. All that information on how to do that, all the links to our app for your top five, is over at the coach's blog. So go to coaching.gallup.com. Mark Pogue is our guest today. He's the executive director for the Clifton Strengths Institute at the University of Nebraska at Lincoln. Mark, I've been waiting for this interview for a long time. Welcome to Call the Coach.
Thanks so much, Jim. It's good to be here. It's good to be back.
No, it's good to have you back. If you've been listening to Call the Coach for a while, you know that I interviewed Mark back last year about this time. You were in Florida at the time. We did a couple strength spotlights on StrengthsQuest. Let's take a little bit second for folks who haven't met you yet. Tell us kind of who you are, some background, and then maybe catch us up on the last year.
Yep, appreciate that, Jim. Yep, it's been a crazy year. I joined Gallup back in 2000, and I think it was early 2001. I had the chance to work with Tom Rath and Don Clifton Chip Anderson, a professor at the University of, actually, he was at Azusa Pacific at the time. He'd been a professor for many years at UCLA. And we had the opportunity to work with the team in creating StrengthsQuest. So the product that most folks are using with college students, high school and college students. Once we figured out what it was and created it, I was given the opportunity to then kind of market and figure out what opportunities there were in terms of us bringing that to education and finding out if there was an actual market for it. So it was a passion project of both Don and Chip's, and they wrote the book together and were so excited about bringing strengths to students. And I know it was a, you know, just a big win for them. And being given the privilege to take that to colleges and universities all over the country for the last 15 years has just been great work. It's one of those, you know, opportunities to do what I do best and also to feed a mission that I have around impacting the lives of students. So that was awesome. And then when we were talking last, I was hanging out in Florida, not just to get a tan, but because I was associated with Tampa General Hospital and I was waiting for a heart transplant. And last time we were talking together, I had tubes running in and out of me connected to a heart pump that was, you know, keeping me alive, and it worked great, but I was ready to get rid of it as quickly as I could. And then January 30th, I got the call. I don't want to tell too many stories, but I was sitting in the DMV getting a Florida driver's license and being asked whether or not I wanted to be an organ donor. When I got the call, I swear to you, it was maybe within a minute of that guy asking me, as a matter of fact, yes, I do want to be a donor, and I get the call. It was great. Yeah, I had to go back to Randy at the DMV afterwards and say, hey, it all worked out. I got my heart. So I've been in recuperation since then. You know, obviously there's a lot of stuff that goes on in trying to tune the meds and everything, but I'm doing great and back to work full time. And then was in the midst of trying to figure out, okay, well, what am I going to do in my role coming back to Gallup? And out of the blue, I got a call from Connie Rath, who is, in charge of the Clifton Strengths Institute, you know, and all the facets of that, not just at the University of Nebraska, but work that we have going on at George Mason University and George Washington, just to name a couple of schools, as well as all the work we do with K-12 with the Institute. And anyway, she said, hey, you know, would you think about moving to Lincoln, Nebraska? And so that started a conversation I was immediately intrigued by, the possibility of actually being on campus and being able to actually experience and do things with students where before I was in a role where I went in, I trained people, and I hoped for the best, and so many of them did amazing jobs, but I always kind of sat on the sidelines cheering them on as opposed to actually being out on the field, if I might use a football metaphor.
And why wouldn't you when you're talking about Nebraska?
Why wouldn't I if I'm talking about Nebraska? So I did. I got to be on the field. I'm working within the College of Business Administration at the University of Nebraska. I am there as a result of a very generous gift from the Clifton family to the CBA that's contributing to a brand new College of Business building that's going up on campus right next to the stadium, right next to Memorial Stadium, and we'll get to occupy that in about a year and a half. I'm part of that gift. So part of it obviously went to the construction of the new building, but a lot of it also is a hands-on experiment that the Cliftons wanted to be a part of in bringing the best implementations of interventions around strengths and strengths development, engagement, well-being, all of our sciences in the lives of students. And so I get to be a part of that, and so far the ride has just been amazing. It's been so fun.
No, that's awesome. We're super excited to have you just down the road. If for those mm-hmm. who don't know, I'm here in Omaha. You're in Lincoln. Literally an hour. I was there yesterday mm-hmm. recruiting. Wore the shirt today in honor of being at mm-hmm. UNL, which is very, very cool. And, of course, we're very proud of our football team and the school down there. We do a lot of recruiting and tech recruiting out of UNL. Mark, today the context is around coaches. And mm-hmm. what we really want to do is have you focus your conversation towards them as we think about how coaches can approach our independent strengths coaches, how they can approach the university, college, even maybe a little bit of high school as we think about that mm-hmm. system. What are we doing, or what are you hoping to do there at UNL that will be a model for these coaches? So if I was a coach, what should I start looking for? And by the way, if you're a coach and you want to know about what we're doing, you can just Google, the Clifton Strengths Institute, UNL. Just Google that, and you'll see all our press releases that have come out around that. But, Mark, what would you tell a coach today as we think about what should they be watching for as we start this work there at UNL?
If I put one word to it, it's career. You know, I think that's probably overused in some ways and probably doesn't capture the full breadth of what it means to think about strengths on the college campus, but I think it's the one that's most accessible. I think it's the one that if you talk to a college student on campus and you ask them why they're there, maybe not like in the 60s where they would say, I'm here to find myself. Instead, I think just about every student, certainly all the students in the CBA that I've had a conversation with, if you ask them that question, they're very focused on how does this prepare me to get a job? How does this prepare me for a career after my college experience? And so I think, that whole avenue of career coaching, of life preparation, all of that, I think is, probably some of the some of those key topics that coaches need to be centering in on and focusing their work on. There's all kinds of opportunities on a campus, but I think those are probably the quickest and easiest avenues to start a conversation.
Is it smart for a coach from the outside to approach the career services group? Because that's kind of where a lot of those things live. You've done this for a long time. You've seen a lot of situations on a lot of college campuses. If we have coaches that are interested in working in this system, is that the right approach, or what kind of advice would you give to them?
I think there could be opportunities there. There would need to be, kind of a light touch because they don't want to feel like they're being encroached on. Most of them, their resources are stretched. The expectation that a student can have when they come in to talk about career, have a catch up with a career counselor on the campus would be, they can expect 20, 30 minutes at the most with a coach, with a career counselor in the career center. So it would certainly be an avenue to pursue. I wouldn't take that away. But I think there's also there's a lot of different ways that you can approach this. One would be, how do I get access to parents and have an opportunity to, help parents know what's available in terms of development around strengths and what they could provide to that, to a particular parent's child. We live in the age of the helicopter parent, and it is rampant. I mean, I'd heard all these stories from educators over the years, and made jokes about helicopter parenting, but the reality is that they're right there. In fact, we'll see stuff coming in on Blackboard where students are supposed to be completing assignments, and we recognize they're coming in on an email address that's not associated with the student. And what's probably happening is that a parent is either way too involved or just, really wishes they were back on the college campus themselves. So it's kind of scary. But I think parents, again, they're the ones that have the propensity to pay for something. So if you're looking for a paying gig, coaching students, if that's, the desire that you have, then that'd be one place you need to figure out, how do I get hooked into those folks? Is it through an alumni association that I could offer those services, or that'd be something that I'd be thinking about, and one way to pursue it. The other way, and the way in which we were able to reach as many campuses as we have, I think there's probably 500 or 600 colleges that we could claim have a significant strengths program. And just like you were mentioning before we got on the air, Jim, that there's sleeper cells out there of strengths, and we've taught thousands of educators how to implement strengths on a campus over the years, and those folks move around. And so if they've left Texas Tech or the University of Minnesota, where there's amazing implementations of strengths, and they went to another school, there's a good chance they took strengths with them. I've had numerous opportunities where folks, especially those in student affairs staff, would come to me and say, hey, could you write a recommendation for me regarding the expertise that I possess around strengths, because I'm applying at this school and they're asking whether or not I have strengths experience. So that has spread it around a lot. It's all over the place. But student affairs would be another area that you should take a look at. It's where strengths can live pretty quickly and easily without having to go through a bunch of, and I used the word Byzantine before, but I'll continue to use it, Jim, the way in which you have to get embedded in actual academic curriculum is long and arduous, and it's a lot easier to go through existing program that might be specific to leadership development or programs that they're providing for first generation college students, or those types of applications, finding those niches that exist where strengths can really benefit a student's experience on campus, and maybe it's even more so for those students that are less likely to be successful on a college campus.
When we think about, and Maureen asked this question in chat, when we think about non-PhDs approaching in an academic setting, mm-hmm. as coaches, a lot of our coaches mm-hmm. aren't PhDs, how have you seen, obviously there's barriers there, have you mm-hmm. seen those barriers overcome for maybe some of these coaches going into that setting?
Besides the maybe the director of a career center, none of those folks have a PhD. They're all working. They might just have their undergrad, and then they're working on a master's in higher education administration, and they got a role within the career services center, with those qualifications. So I would say most of the career counseling, specific career counseling that's going on a college campus, is not somebody that possesses a PhD. You're a practitioner. You're not there to necessarily research the impact of the strengths coaching that you're doing, although we're going to try to help you do that. We're going to try to get some of that research going at the University of Nebraska through the Strengths Institute. no, I think there's opportunities there even without, degrees that, you go in there with your certification and you're willing to help students. I think you've got enough to get started with.
What do you think when we think of successful programs that are currently going on with universities, and especially when we think about independent coaches? Are you aware of any where it's working? I know we do quite a bit of work, and there's some great stories there. But are you aware of any others that are maybe have some independent folks working in them?
Independent. Oh, that's a good question. Again, it's these larger implementations probably where there's probably more of a need. You know, I don't off the top of my head. That'd have to be something I'd do some research on to kind of.
Maybe we could look into that a little bit.
Yeah.
Get something back out to the coaches.
It'd be great if we could create a network of those folks, and create some kind of community that those folks could gather in and be sharing their stories and ways in which they were able to, make a connection. I think,
one of the other
ways that I would think about it, Jim, is if you are willing, as a coach, if you're willing to teach adjunct, and you go in and you say, hey, these are the skills I possess, this is the knowledge that I have. Very specifically, it's around, strengths-based development, but if there are courses available around leadership, around management, around working in teams, that's a huge need on a college campus is how do we help students work effectively in teams. And if you could go in and say, hey, I can teach a course on this and get that adjunct connection, maybe teaching one course a week might be all you need. And I would look at every facet of higher ed. I wouldn't focus exclusively on the four-year institutions. There's great work going on at the community college level, and that might be a great place to start as well.
No, that's a great suggestion, especially the community college. That may be a way into seeing other institutions as we think about that. We went really, really fast over this, but when we think of Strengths Finder versus Strengths Quest, and let me say, you mentioned a minute ago, we do have a specific Facebook Strengths Quest group. So if you go to, facebook.com/group/StrengthsQuest, I think I got that. If you didn't, just search Strengths Quest on Facebook. That is a place people can go and we can have these conversations, and I'll be monitoring those and working with Mark on this. But it'd be great that group has about 65 or 70. It'd be good to boost that up and get enough for a significant conversation. But Mark, when we think about, especially in lieu of, we just made a price change. So now Strengths Finder is $15 and Strengths Quest is still $10. Dollars from that standpoint, but what can you give me a quick overview? How is Strengths Quest different than Strengths Finder? Mm-hmm. And when we think about what coaches could use it for, what are the benefits for them switching onto that platform?
Yeah, it's so funny that you talk about the price change because for years my educators were coming to me and going, "Why can't we get education pricing?" Well, now you got it.
Now you can.
Just because we raised the price of the other code.
Yeah. No, exactly.
Right. So. I think, primarily the content that's wrapped around the website and what we offer on the website is more appropriate for a student audience. What we've tried to do is provide, a lot of information and content there, probably more so than our other sites. I mean, we were I know we're offering 2.0 as a downloadable book now, but we had the Strengths Quest book. We've had it on the site for the last, I can't remember. I think it's probably been 7 or 8 years that we've had both a PDF and HTML version of it there. We also have the team tool, being able to put team maps together, either both, and you can switch it back and forth and either have those team maps map to the four domains of leadership, as well as doing it alphabetically, and students can do those on the fly in teams that they're put in classrooms, and it does get used quite a bit. I was kind of amazed. I got to campus, and folks were telling me how much that tool was one that they used as a resource and that they shared with students quite often. So that was great to hear. The other thing that we have on the Strengths Quest site is the opportunity for administrators of a particular implementation of Strengths, they can actually get themselves set up as an administrator of a particular set of codes. And so what that allows for is they can actually monitor whether or not students have completed the assessment. And so you actually have the opportunity to do that on Strengths Quest, where that's just really not possible in any of, of our other kind of e-commerce offerings. So those are the big ones. All they have to do is go to strengthsquest.com, you know, log in, and then I think it's under, let's see, it's probably under educators. There's a tab for educators. You click there, and there's an option there about administrators, and you can click on that, and you'll have to communicate with us to have us set that up for you and then load codes into that particular sample. But you can manage. I have it for myself where I've gone out and done individual groups, and I have probably 7 or 8 different groups of codes that are associated with different presentations that I've made and specific audiences. And I can go in and look up those codes. I can see their 5 strengths. I can know whether or not they've completed it. It's not that sophisticated. It's a pretty simple administrative site, but it's really helpful for those folks that are doing it in a higher ed environment.
Yeah, and I want to highlight a few technical differences. When we think of on the Gallup Strength Center, you buy one code that can go to multiple people. On Strengths Quest, you buy many codes, and it's one code per person. So it's a little bit different way of managing it. Some of our coaches have had a little hard time wrapping their hands around that. Their head around that. I do want to emphasize now on both platforms, StrengthsFinder 2.0 book, ebook available, and like you said, Strengths Quest book, ebook is available. That's a great resource to have, a physical copy of that, and you can buy those copies. They're $20. The books are just $20 on shop.gallup.com. So if you want to head over there and pick those up, there's all kinds of resources for you. Mark, I also want to say on our YouTube page, you and I sat down, I alluded to this in the beginning, but let me emphasize, I have 2 hours of you walking through the whole platform for Strengths Quest. All on video, and Mark will look a little different back then. He's looking a little healthier today and smiling a lot more today. But we recorded 2 hours of the site, the Strengths Quest site. We went through it all. We talked about the history of Strengths Quest. And so if you haven't watched those yet, go to YouTube and search Gallup Strength Center, and you'll see it is in a strength spotlight, so you want to catch that. If you have any questions, you can email me as well or ping me, and I'll get that to you. Mark, what about international schools? When we think about, we often focus on the U.S., it has this broken out, and are there strength schools that are strengths-based going on outside of the U.S.?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are. We get information. We don't have a lot of direct contact with them because basically they've just set up their system and done that without us having a lot of specific contact with them. But yeah, we get messages all the time of institutions all over Taiwan. I know we've had different pings over time. Australia, obviously, in the UK, and a lot in Canada, if we want to consider our friends to the north, international, which we should. And we've got the entire language set loaded in, so that's updated, and so if you want to have your students take it in their first language, that typically is available to you. And if it's in our set, which I think, what do we have, 26, 17 different languages that are loaded in that one, and so all of that. Now the book is not translated. We do have a Spanish version of the book, conversational Spanish version of the book, that if you wanted to, somebody would need to email us about that, if that was something that they were interested in, because I think it's still just in hard copy print. We don't have an online version of that.
Mark, what's the best way, can they contact us right through the Strengths Quest site? Is that the best way if they have some questions to do that?
Yeah, for anything specific to Strengths Quest, it's easiest just to go through there. I know eventually, we've heard, I don't know, Jim, you're aware of this, probably much more so than I am, but we know that there is a plan. We rolled out a new version of Gallup.com, and I know that there's plans to kind of bring everything under a a particular umbrella, especially with the Strengths Center. And I think the plan is that Strengths Quest would be pulled into that. So, when you go to strengthscenter.com, you'll be able to see Strengths Quest as well, as opposed to having it as a completely separate site. But that, I know that's out a ways. And probably means that we're not going to see a refresh to the Strengths Quest site until that happens. That's my guess. I haven't had specific conversations around that, but I would assume we wouldn't throw a lot of resources at it until we were ready to integrate it in. And at that point, it does need a refresh. It's time for us to go back and rethink some of the things that we have on there. I think there's a lot of utility there still. One of the things the students can do is they can go in and actually just pull all the action items time specific to their five strengths. So if they've logged on and they hit my strengths quest, they're actually able to go in and pull out the action item specific to themselves as a student, but there's also, we've also loaded in the teacher action items because we do have a lot of educators that use the strengths quest site. And then we have managing action items that I think either came, I don't think it's 2.0, I think it goes all the way back to now discover your strengths. So there's some other content on there that helps students start to think about themselves in the role of being employed somewhere and within an organization as opposed to just themselves as a student too. So that's there.
Lots, tons of resources. Again, go back to those videos. We cover them all. Mohammed asked this question in chat. Are there any studies regarding college students coaching outside of the U.S.? And then let me throw in, what have we documented for universities inside the United States, and who's doing it the best, besides Lincoln, of course, who's doing it the best right now?
Yeah, and right now I wouldn't claim that we're doing it the best. I think you know, we certainly have the potential and the resources to make that happen. And we have the approval of administration, which I think is that's more difficult than getting the money together in terms of doing ongoing longitudinal research, which is what we have planned for the work that we're doing there in the Strengths Lab there at the Institute. For Mohammed, I cannot think of a resource, you know, in terms of the research, in terms of the coaching. In general, you know, and this is working off some information that was collected and you know, over the years we've had a lot of different research projects that have been applied within the context of students and strengths, mostly looking at strength self-efficacy, hope, engagement.
And Shane's work would be something folks could kind of, right? So Shane Lopez,
right,
around hope, he is kind of that intersection for us, right? And
right,
with hope and education. And can you talk to that a little bit? How does he dovetail? And we've interviewed him too. If you can, you can Google,
right,
Shane Lopez, Gallup Called the Coach. We've interviewed him twice.
That's excellent. Well, Shane is actually coming down, or actually coming up from Lawrence next week to speak to my students there in the business class that I'm teaching, and so he'll be talking about a little bit about hope, but as well he'll be talking about the Gallup Purdue Index, and that was the other piece that I was going to mention. But specific to what we've done with students in the context of their development around strengths in a college setting, what we know is that strengths impacts both hope and engagement. We know that we can see a significant bump in the levels of hope that students experience on a college campus when they're experiencing a strengths development program. They're in a development program as opposed to strengths identification, which we talked about the last time we were on. And I'm amazed that I can actually remember that after everything that I've been through, but somehow that popped in. So we know that it impacts hope. We know that it impacts engagement, and that's engagement from Gallup's perspective. It's emotional engagement. It's, do I have the opportunity to do what I do best every day? It's, you know, those questions, that's what we're using to measure that with students. We know then that both engagement and hope can impact academic performance, and we know that it can impact overall life well-being. You know, so we know strengths has an impact in, you know, some pretty dramatic ways on how a student experiences college. And then the next extension of that is the Gallup Purdue Index. And so students then, you know, what we did was we went out and we surveyed, you know, and I know Brandon's been on, so this has been covered obviously
just last time.
So I'm not gonna steal that thunder again or try to repeat that. But you know, we interviewed all of these alumni and then made these connections back to, you know, experiences that students had in college. It's a great start for us to figure out how do we craft the perfect experience for a college student on a campus to prepare them to be engaged and to have high well-being once they're in the work world. And, you know, and that's our major emphasis within the Strengths Lab there at UNL. So those are the things we're working on. And Shane's going to be talking with my students next week. I've got 700 of them. So we get together in a big concert hall, 350 at a time, and we share with them kind of the, you know, the what. And then I also have those students broken up into what we call recitation. It's a word that really has lost a lot of meaning. I think it was something that the University of Nebraska started using back in the teens, the other teens.
Yeah.
But they're broken up into groups of about 30, and there's an instructional assistant that works with them, and that's really the how. How do we actually implement some of the things that we heard in lecture?
That's great. John asked this question from chat, kind of the purpose and the function and the goals of the Institute when we think about where are we trying to go with this, both here in the U.S. and abroad, and what are you hoping for, just maybe one or two goals here in the next couple of years?
Yeah, well, I think we do want to have the perfect strengths implementation for college students. That's what we're working towards. And, you know, lofty goal, and it's going to take us a while to get there. We've got a great a great situation in terms of where we can apply it and a lot of support from the administration to make it happen. So right now, everybody's saying yes. And so we are redesigning, there's a set of four courses that all CBA students at the University of Nebraska go through. It is what they call professional enhancement. They're typically 8-10 weeks in the fall, and they'll have one of those every year, freshman through senior year on the campus, and some of them can take it online as well. But the intent is, in that first one, is to really get them set to be successful in college, and then those classes subsequent to that are really intent on resume and LinkedIn site development. It's preparing how to interview, also thinking about possible jobs and roles that might fit them in terms of who they are and in terms of the strengths they possess, as well as the skills and knowledge that they're pursuing within their formal education. And then that last year, that senior year, is really about preparing them to go out and be successful interviewing and land a job. And then, so that's a big part of what we call the Strengths Institute. Within the Strengths Institute, there is the Strengths Lab. The Institute covers, four major components. There's actually going to eventually be a director of research that is will be a chair in leadership within the College of Business. And that's not under my responsibility, although I'll be involved with the education part of that with the students. And it involves leadership and entrepreneurship, management, all of those categories that can, fall within the context of a business school. The Strengths Lab, which I mentioned briefly before, but its purpose is to have that perfect strengths implementation for students. You know, what we're dealing with right now in this first class for freshmen is that we're looking at just introducing them to strengths, helping them understand their own strengths, and be able to apply them in the context of their academic world that they live in at that time. You know, we're looking at topics like time management and some of those basics of being successful on campus through a strengths lens. So everything is going to be strengths based in this course. There's not any sessions that we do that does not have a revisiting of strengths. I think the other big thing that we're doing is trying to help students understand how important it is to consider your strengths in the context of relationships on campus. And so we'll do all of that. We're going to look at teams. We're going to look at and then as we look further into it, we want students to understand that, not only are you responsible for being a successful student on campus, which is probably a big enough goal, lofty enough goal as a freshman, but in addition to that, they've got to start thinking into the future a little bit about, okay, what does this mean for me in the context of me eventually being a manager in an organization somewhere? What does it mean for me to be a leader and to be interacting with other people? Because just with the name organization, it implies you're doing it with other people. And we have a challenge with that because we're dealing with Gen Z. And we know that these are folks that are, right there immediately trying to get, something to happen for themselves on their phones, and the information is immediately available, their answers are immediately available, and they love that immediate satisfaction of getting on a phone and, on a device and being able to get what they need. And we're now asking them to think into the future a bit, and we've got plenty of those students that have futuristic in their top five, and they immediately get that, but there's a lot of others that are like going, and why is this important to me now? And so a lot of it has to do with us convincing them and helping them understand why what they're doing right now is going to mean so much to them in the future. And I think that's the goal of the lab. In addition to that, we're doing a lot of great research around it. We've already got a pre and a post going on with the students that I have in my class, so we're trying to see if I've created a bump on strength self-efficacy. We're designing some control studies that will, you know, we'll end up having a control waitlisted group, and we have three different interventions that we're going to be doing with students around strengths. There's some crazy ideas that we have out there as a result, because of an opportunity that we have to work with the Brain Lab that's over in Memorial Stadium. They've got some of the most sophisticated equipment over there to be able to monitor brain activity. They got an amazing MRI. We're going to be doing probably doing some studies that involve the endocrine lab, or the nickname of it is the spit lab. And that's another one that sits right over there in Memorial Stadium. So as much as we think of that associated with the football team, there is amazing scientists and some really smart people over there in the stadium that are going to help us do some, maybe even some physical markers as opposed to just response, opinion response or to folks have to surveys, which would be amazing. So all of that's planned for the Institute. The other thing that we're doing, and I need to mention this because it's a big emphasis on the part of our CEO, Jim Clifton. He really, is so committed to business creation in this country and doing that through entrepreneurship. And so all of my students, all 700 of those, have gone through the EP10, and we have results on them. They're going to use that to help them think about their development within the context of the possibility of starting businesses. We're also going to be identifying high performers or high potential performers within that 700 that we assess, and we're going to be offering them some really cool opportunities to get involved with classes and other offerings that would help them think about the opportunity to be an entrepreneur and to start a business.
Mark, we use the word institute, and you're at a university, so that might imply that we might have some kind of influence on degrees. So are we thinking in the future there may be some strengths-based degrees that come out of this? Has there been any thought into that? They're kind of asking about that.
I've actually had some inquiries about that just from probably folks that lived in Lincoln that are coaches and that are Gallup coaches that saw the announcements that kind of appeared locally about the Institute. I think so. Eventually there's going to be, I don't know that, we're going to have a PhD in strengths-based development anytime soon, but definitely within this column that we have created around having a chair, a Clifton chair within the CBA, I think there is the potential for us to have maybe degrees in leadership and maybe master's degrees that start to pop up, maybe not in the next 1 or 2 years, but down the road there would be the potential for that. In addition to that, I think there's also going to be some minors that will become available, certainly one in entrepreneurship. There's actually one on the campus in entrepreneurship right now, but it's not necessarily strengths-based. So if we had an entrepreneurship minor with that opportunity to have the strengths influence and the context of strengths embedded into that, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, and how important will EP10 be in this? You've mentioned it a couple times. It sounds fairly significant.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yep. We're, obviously EP10, just like StrengthsFinder, is created in a way that we can, that anybody can benefit from it, in terms of thinking about their own development and how they apply their strengths to be successful in whatever role they choose. So if they're starting a business, certainly having the insights of the EP10 would be really helpful for them. But it also gives us an opportunity, to look at students that have taken the assessment, and if they do indicate that they have high potential, it'll be one of those opportunities to come back to them and say, listen, have you ever thought about this? First of all, have you ever started a business? What was that like for you? And have you ever thought about, maybe pursuing that as, an opportunity for you in the future? Even if it ends up being that you get in a place where you can do that in the future, if we've planted the seed and helped them understand you've got amazing talent to start something. And which ironically is kind of the theme that Dean Plowman at the CBA has for the entire College of Business. It's, let's start something. And so it's a perfect place for us to be in terms of helping students think about that.
I want to put a special request in for a podcast studio or webcast studio there at the new institute. I'll come down to Lincoln. We can do them live right from there. So not really. Yeah. We can do them great from here as well. Some questions from Maureen about your top five, Mark. Mm-hmm. And how will those fit in? Coach, of course, the coaches would ask this question.
No, that's good.
How does that fit into your leadership role there, and how do you plan to maximize those?
Yeah. Okay, so I have self-assurance, activator, ideation, intellection, and command. Got strategic pretty high, got individualization pretty high, and have competition up there too. I don't look at all like a typical academic, and I don't look at all even like a lot of staff people there. So I think part of my role is, it's really funny. I was looking at the EP10 results, and maybe you can tell me this, Jim. I saw the word, I think, at one point in time we called it like creativity or creative thinking.
Creative thinker is what I...
And is that the same one as disruptor?
Yeah, it is now. Yeah, that's the new mapping.
Yeah, so I'm looking at that and I saw the word disruptor and I went, yeah. Ideation fits. I've got, so the creative thinking, but I really embrace the whole idea of the disruptor thing. And I think it's, I do it in a congenial enough way. I'm not in there just trying to be a bull in a china shop. I recognize that I'm in an environment that, probably doesn't see a lot of me around. I'm taking my time to get there. But I think, to a large degree, I am a disruptor. I'm there to shake things up and to help people think about, new approaches that could be more effective in terms of preparing students to go out and be successful. My daughter's a freshman at the University of Nebraska. She's actually in my class. And so I get immediate feedback every week from her, honest feedback, sometimes brutal, about how I did, and how her friends are reacting to what I shared with them. And I think there's an amazing opportunity for us to, and especially for coaches that possess the talent to do it, is to get out there and to be that, that presenter, that person that introduces strengths to students in a way that is both winsome and attractive and compelling. Because I think there's a lot of education that goes on right now where the expectation is that everybody has learner and input, and so you should be excited about learning this simply because you don't know it, versus somebody stepping in and saying, I have to make this compelling to you. I have to convince you of the efficacy of this, and you need it. And they don't get that much. That doesn't happen much on a college campus, and I'm there to do that. So as much as I left a formal sales role with Gallup, a few years ago, I can't help but sell. That has to be a part of my DNA. So I think that's probably the way my strengths work with him.
Yeah, part of that high influence for you, I'm sure, yep. From that standpoint of influencing people. You alluded to the EP10 changes, and I have a moment, and I'm talking to a whole bunch of people at the same time, which is always nice. If you took EP10 and you haven't logged back into the Gallup Strength Center and pulled your new report, those all changed just a couple weeks ago. Now, what it is not like all of a sudden your talents changed, right? We just changed some of the titles. We tuned it. If you were a part of the StrengthsFinder movement maybe 10 years ago, you would have seen us tune StrengthsFinder as well. Some things came out. We changed a few of the labels, the theme names. We consolidated. There were some things that we did as we learned in that first million. Same thing is happening with EP10 right now. And it's an exciting time because you can kind of have some influence, although I think this is the final cut I think we're making right here at this point when we get done. But that being said, new reports, a few new labels, and I agree with you, by the way, that disruptor label, so much better than the creative thinker in it. And I got a chance to teach this at the Rake School yesterday to these students, and to use that word disruptor, they really, I did this last year, and it was creative thinker. It was okay. You said disruptor, and man, kids' eyes, they lit up because they think that's pretty cool, especially for those who are in that place of disruption. And love to come in and kind of stir the pot and say, what could be? What if we could do this? Like, what if it was this way? I have high ideation, so I do the same thing all the time. Mm-hmm. Come in as, hey, what if we did start doing these live webcasts around the world, a couple times a week? That just happened here at Gallup, right? We did some disruptive technology in getting this stuff out. So that's the changes that have gone on EP10. If you took it and you log in, those reports have changed. You can automatically open them up and now get access to them that way and get it done. Mark, I want to kind of, as I bring this in for a landing, any final words? When we think about our coaches, how would you encourage them in what they're doing, and if they wanted to get involved, what would be the best way for them to kind of hook into us? You know, we have some new teams to help them inside here. If mm-hmm. they want some information on StrengthsQuest and getting their code set up and getting that admin set up, we have new teams to help them do that. But what would you tell them, and how would you say what's the best way to connect into us?
Yep. Well, I'll go back to what we started with. I'd say focus on helping students understand their opportunities around what comes after college and thinking about career. I think it's your best hook, even though you might be, still in a role trying to help students get past that whole Gen Z thing of being right here in the moment, but really starting to think about their future. There's certainly some great potential for having those conversations. And I think, you know, as I've been doing a ton of feedbacks myself, so, you know, I hadn't been in the role of a coach for many, many years within Gallup, and now, you know, I do 10 or 15 a week. I do 10 or 15 coaching sessions a week with students, and I think the thing that they get most excited about is really understanding their strengths in the context of understanding others. So if you can place yourself in a position where not only you're helping those students understand their own strengths, but also understanding how that explains and describes their interactions with others, because as well, Gen Z just is very, very relational. They run in packs, and so it's a great opportunity to kind of take advantage of that need that they have to understand what it means to be in community. So those would be a couple of the places that I'd attack, just in kind of that broader sense of the word. Does that help? Is there anything else more specific that
I think so, no. And then the right way to contact us, right, just through the StrengthsQuest page. So if they go to StrengthsQuest.com, if they got some information, there's some the ways to contact us on that page. Get those emails in. We'll get our staff back out to you. And we have, like I said, I mentioned before, we have more staff than ever working on StrengthsQuest there to help you. If you want to administer an administration at a school or you're helping do that, we have tools available for you. You need to get set up as an admin, and there's some work we need to do to get that done. Actually, Lindsay helps me with that. She'll get on the phone with you and help you with that, and she'd love to be able to do that as well. Mark, anything further?
It's easy. You know, the admin stuff is it's really not an issue at all in terms of, getting that set up. And, it is fairly painless to get this going and get a group of students involved with Strengths.
Oh, very good. Mark, thanks for taking the last 45 minutes to do this one.
Yeah.
I told you in the pre-show, great just to see you to begin with. We're super excited you're just down the road, and I've kind of fallen in love with StrengthsQuest as I've gotten to know the operating system through you, and we've got some really cool stuff, I think, coming with StrengthsQuest that probably not supposed to talk about, but I will just let folks know there's lots of really interesting work coming when we think about, especially what we're doing with our Strengths Institute at UNL, and so we'd love to have you engage with us on that. Many of our coaches don't even know that's an option, so if the first time you're listening to this, go back, get some more information about it. We've got plenty of videos around it as well, and love to bring you on speed. I'll thank everyone for coming out today and remind everyone to take full advantage of all the resources we have available at the Gallup Strength Center. Just GallupStrengthCenter.com, or in this case, StrengthsQuest.com. There we go. And I wanted to put Gallup in front of that and say Gallup StrengthsQuest, but it's just StrengthsQuest.com. Send us your questions or comments to our email address, coaching@gallup.com. You can also catch the recorded audio and video of this program, as well as all the past ones. They're all available for you, including the links to our Facebook page. I mentioned we have a special StrengthsQuest group just to talk about this stuff, and you can join us. All the links for that are available over the coach's blog. Just go to coaching.gallup.com. If you have an idea for a blog post, we are accepting applications and interviewing guest writers, so you can send us an email. Again, that coaching@gallup.com, and put guest blogger in the subject line. We'll get back to you and get you the requirements for that as well. We have now some 30 or 35 global meetups going on around the world. If there's one not in your city, we'd love to have you help us start one. In that, it's super easy, and I have directions on how to get those done in our Facebook group, on the Called to Coach Facebook group. So not as hard as it seems. If you have questions and want to help us do that, you can contact me directly, jim_collison@gallup.com. Don't forget, we also have Android and iPhone apps available for you. Mark, you mentioned this Gen Z, and that's who I was teaching yesterday. And as soon as I said, hey, did you know you can get this, your top five on your phone, like 16 of them right at the moment were downloading the app to their phone.
Yeah, just to add to that, I've got, like I said, 350 students, big lecture hall, actually a concert hall, and I still have them having, interactions with each other around their strengths, and the first thing that they do when they come into class is I say, get your app out, get your strengths up in front of you. I'm not going to have the expectation that you have them memorized, but I want them available to you, and they pull them up, and we start our conversation. So
that's awesome.
It's a really, it's a simple tool, but it's really useful.
When I'm on the road recruiting and we're doing career fairs, I just pulled my phone out of my back pocket and hit the Strengths Finder app. By the way, either store search Strength Finder totally free. Just download it, log in with the email address you used when you created your account and get logged in. Your top five will be right there for you to remember. On Android, you can take a screenshot of that, make it your lock screen, and then every time you unlock your phone, which for most people is 61 times a day, believe it or not, you will see your top five and you'll remember those, and that'll be a tool. So we have all kinds of tools available for you as well. We want to thank everyone for joining us today. If you've enjoyed this, and I have, so share it with others. We'd love to have you do that out through the various channels on Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn. Love to have you do it, and we'll be back next time with another Call to Coach, and that, with that, we'll say goodbye, everybody.